Hello, and welcome to the first in a series of looks at different medical simulators. In this case, we're looking at Full Code Medical Simulation, which is an iOS-based app. You can use it on your iPhone or your iPad. It has offline ability, so you can take it with you on the go. There is a free version with about 15 cases. There's a cheaper intermediate version for about $4 a month, and that includes 26 cases with a couple of rotating random cases. And if you really like it, you can get the full paid version for $11 a month, and that includes 126 cases. These cases are authored by different people, and the different authors, some cases are very in-depth and have a lot going to them, and some are quite simple. As the basis of this simulation, it is a scripted or trigger-based event that is, let's say the patient has a certain condition, you give them a drug, that's the trigger, and either it would make them better or make them worse. And same goes for other interventions you would do, as well as the time. However, they do note on the website that the game is designed to be closed or paused. So if you are taking care of somebody and you're worried that they're going to die while you put your phone away during landing, you don't have to worry. You can simply just tab out of the app and it won't make any difference. So I've selected a random case here. I want to give you kind of a review of the simulation as well as kind of working for this case and seeing how it goes. So this is the start of the case. This is case number 59, near syncope with weakness. And the EMS report says we have a 56-year-old male found supine in a restaurant after nearly passing out. He was diaphoretic, unable to stand. No lateralizing weaknesses noted. Face is symmetric, heart rate 150, blood pressure 70. The triage nurse then has a handoff from EMS, and she says he's 56 with near syncope, hypotensive tachycardic luxation, no chest pain, diffusely weak. So it tells us there might be something going on with his heart, with his blood pressure that we need to look at. And full disclosure, I am not a medical professional. I just have a bit of enthusiasm for this as well as kind of general science apps. So let's click begin. And we start off and we are in this nicely modeled, and I would say nicely modeled for a mobile app, this ER room or hospital room. We can actually click on the crash card and it gives us crash card options. We can click on the IV card, it gives us IV options, or the ultrasound, or even the monitor. So it's kind of nice that we can click different machines, although, oh, the airway, I clicked the respirator over there and it didn't do anything, but there's an airway cart. But anyway, so there's a patient. Touching the patient or tapping on them doesn't really do anything. Maybe in the future that'll be something they add, or maybe in different cases they've gone ahead and changed it. But there are the four tabs on the left side and the four tabs on the right-hand side, and those are kind of how you navigate. And my guess is the flow can be however you want, but I just like to go start on the left side, go all the way down for all the tabs, and then go to the right side and go all the way down. But it's really up to you how you want to play it. There isn't much sound to this game, so I'm not going to include sound in this video. The sound you'll get is the sound of the monitor beeping, which is quite annoying and frankly is not that helpful. But nonetheless, let's start on the left-hand side here. So we learn this guy's name is Richard Levin. He's 40 years old. He's a full code. He's 72 kilograms. He presents with acute onset lightheadedness after dinner. He was halfway through dinner when he suddenly felt weak and could not stand up. During dinner, he had two martinis and two glasses of wine. However, that's not unusual for him, so he's a pretty big drinker. This gives us his past medical history. He has P, atrial fibrillation, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, sciatica, the drugs he's on. He's allergic to tree nuts. He doesn't really have a family history, as it says non-contributory. He drinks 2 to 3 drinks per day, so he's a fairly strong drinker and smokes half a pack a day, but he doesn't do any illicit drugs, marijuana, cocaine, any of the fun stuff. And then below this, as we scroll down, this is where we get to the review of systems, and this is where we can go ahead and ask questions about how are your eyes, how's your throat feel, do you have any pain? That's essentially what these are, and you wouldn't, of course, ask all of these of somebody who came in this condition, but since this is a simulation and there's no risk to the patient, we can go ahead and just click all of them. And it's fun that it gives a little pause instead of just showing up immediately. It says asking, as if someone's in the background asking the patient these questions, or you yourself are asking these questions. And we can go through here and we see like he has general fatigue, no weight loss, no vision changes, no runny nose. He's positive for palpitations and near syncope, but he has no chest pain. He has slight shortness of breath. He has nausea, no rashes. Everything else is normal. Ooh, we forgot psychiatric. He has no hallucinations. That's great. So we can go to the next tab. This is exam. So this is where we are looking ourselves for problems. And it says general status, GCS of 14, and he is uncomfortable. That's too bad. You can start at the top here at the air. It has airway breathing circulation, the three most important right at the top, and we can click those. And it tells us his airway is good. He has good breath sounds. And he has thready peripheral pulses, which doesn't sound great. But same thing again, since it's a simulation, we can go ahead and just click on down through all of these and see if there's any information that's helpful. Obviously, the GU system, as in a normal penis and testicles with no masses, that's not necessarily helpful. But we see skin is cool, pale, diaphoretic, so he's a little bit shocky. He has that hypotension, so that is something we'll have to deal with. One of my gripes, or one of the changes I guess they could make, is they don't put in donning personal protective equipment within the kind of exam. I guess if you're asking questions, you don't need personal protective equipment. Maybe a mask, maybe not, but probably not gloves. However, on the physical exam, there should be an action for it. But when you go to stabilize, where these are physical interventions, it doesn't have it. However, if you go to investigate bedside test or investigate on this side, intervene procedures, there is going to be, where is it? This is my gripe, is that they hide it. Where are you? Procedures. So intervene procedures, and we will see on here, there's don personal protective equipment and decontaminate them, hazmat activation. So those really should be earlier on and not over in the later tabs, but that's just a change that maybe they can make in the future. And I'm not sure what control different authors have over what interventions and what steps are placed where in the menu. But let's go ahead and put in an IV, put him on the monitor. He doesn't need chest compressions. And when you click monitor, it shows on the monitor there. He has a heart rate of 155. He's 100% on oxygen, on room oxygen, I should say, or room air. He has a low blood pressure and he has a decent respiration rate. We'll give him a cannula anyway. We'll give him some fluid. Why not? We have vascular access, but it does have pacer and defibrillation options, vascular access, including like an IO or an arterial line. And there are options for intubating him, including drugs for things like RSIs. So it, as far as some of the games go or simulations, some of the case-based scripting ones are pretty simplistic, and when you're dealing with your patient, you may only have an option for about four or five different drugs or four or five different exams or procedures, and I think that's where this platform really excels. If we click the investigate, we can see this is just bedside tests, and then there's lab work. There's a lot to this, and I think that's a much more realistic simulation in that you're almost inundated in the real world with how many tests, how many procedures, how many things you can do. And it's up to you as the provider in this case to decide what fits. And I think that is a much better representation than some of the others where it's three items, or, you know, you're given A, B, C, and D, which one do you want to do? So this is, I think, much more realistic. So we're going to go to differential tab, close this. At this point, we know he's hypotensive, he has a history of AFib, so he has some sort of heart problem. He might be allergic to tree nuts if he ate some. So we can go in and now pick differentials. So let's say anaphylaxis, we'll go cardiovascular, we'll say this one, we'll remove that, say that one, AFib with rapid ventricular response. Sure. Myocardial infarction. He said he had no pain. Supraventricular tachycardia, vasovagal syncope. We could go to environmental. Let's see what's in here. Oh, he may have had a human bite. That's not good. We'll put it on there for fun. Let's see what other options we have. Infectious disease. How about COVID-19? So now we have a list of, well, let me go to the neurological. See, is there a stroke in here? How about ischemic stroke? So maybe you had a stroke, but this is our differential. And now, as we move to the right-hand side and investigate and intervene, we can go ahead and try and remove some of these, either rule them in or rule them out. And if we click on like anaphylaxis, the little circle with the eye, it gives us a rundown of this is what this is, these are the symptoms you would find, and what the treatment is, which is really helpful if you're clicking on these and it's like, I have no idea what this means, but maybe I think it sounds right. So actually, let's go to human bite. Do we get any info? Look at that. Human bites are most common, or most commonly from a fight bite caused by a punch to the teeth. Didn't know that. Lacerations can become infected with oral flora, leading to severe complications. IV antibiotic treatment is often required to treat acute infection. Neat. All right, so if we had a human bite, we might want to go give him some antibiotics. All right, so let's go to the investigate tab. We'll go here. We can do an ECG. We can get blood sugar. How about we'll do a cardiac ultrasound because we're worried about his heart? We can do a whole bunch of lab tests, D-dimer, lactate lipase, liver function, magnesium phosphate, troponin. How about a urinalysis? This other test tab is when you're doing a case and it's one of the specific case and it needs a special test. That test may show up in here. So these other labs sometimes can be changed by authors, and some of them, you may open this tab and there's three tests in here. Some may have like 100, so it just depends. But we'll go C-reactive protein. We said COVID-19 he might have, so let's do that. How about ethanol level? And how about a urine tox screen? And then imaging, we can nuke them as much or as little as we want, as well as an MRI. So let's do, how about a CT of his chest? And let's get a chest X-ray, even though they're kind of one and the same. The CT is actually better in some cases. And what else do we want in here? That's probably it. So when you click perform, they start filling in the panel. And it's really interesting how the authors will upload actual EKGs. So I can hear as the tests are rolling in. And it's fun, the little, I guess that's the supposed to be the nurse tells us that the labs, the results are in. But as the results come in, we can see them over here, and we'll click on the ECG as it's running away from me there. And here it gives you a nice ECG. You can actually zoom in, which is really nice. You can move it around. And if you really wanted to dig into interpreting this yourself, or you can also look at the bottom corner there and it says interpretation, atrial fibrillation with rapid ventricular response. I would take that to mean he needs to be cardioverted because he looks like he's unstable. His heart rate's 150, his blood pressure is 83. And if you recall, we did give him some fluid and it didn't really do too much for him. His blood sugar is good. Anything that's colored, like this bun, or this potassium, that means it's not normal. And if you click the little eye, it gives you the ranges, so you don't have to memorize this. Although if you are a professional, you might already know most of these values in your head. But we can see for him, there's very little wrong, slightly low potassium. This bun is somewhat elevated. There's nothing kind of crazy that jumps out. His magnesium is a bit low. His urinalysis is normal. He has, oh, yeah, so he's 20 milligrams per deciliter. I'm not sure if that's a drink or not, but he has about four or five drinks in him, which matches what he said on his history. If we click the chest CT, it says it's normal. And we click the chest X-ray, it says it's normal. So his chest is fine. Now we can click intervene. This is where we have some procedures, like if he needed a chest tube, if he needed a lumbar puncture, if we wanted to lower the bed. we can go ahead and give them different blood bank items. There's a lot of meds. So this is where I think this simulation goes really well. He said he wasn't feeling great, so it gives him some ondansetron because he was nauseous. So do that. It says ondansetron given. I wish there was a way to go and ask the patient again how they are feeling. If we go to patient, let's see, GI nausea. No, so it doesn't update. It didn't say it fixes nausea. But nonetheless, there are a lot of drugs, a lot of options. Like there's most of the antibiotics and antivirals and antifungals in here. They do change based on the author, but this is great for a mobile app that you can sit and play on an airplane. So now here's the consultants. So we know he has a heart issue. Let's consult cardiology. It says the patient sounds unstable with an exclamation point. Uh-oh. You need to hang up the phone and deal with this arrhythmia. I'll be right there. So while he's probably not going to walk in that door behind us, we should probably deal with it so we can cardiovert him. So we'll intervene. Let's give him some fentanyl. And how about some ketamine and bolus, not an infusion. We'll give him those. Let's watch his blood pressure tank. This will be fun. So went down a little bit. 76 now instead of where it was. And then we'll go to stabilize, place pads for monitoring, and synchronize cardioversion. And oh, look at that. The crash cart comes over. Let's see if his chest moves. Did it do it? Or did it just place the pads? It just placed the pads. So click synchronize cardioversion. Said 3, 2, 1 clear in the corner. We saw his chest move. And now his heart rate is 86. His blood pressure practically doubled. And it looks much better. And we can investigate, do a test, and repeat the ECG. We'll perform that and see what he changed to. And now it says normal sinus rhythm. Okay, great. So he's doing better. However, if we go and consult cardiology, cardiology gives us the same answer. I can call cardiology all day. They're not really going to do anything. And if you call the wrong person, like let's say we'll call hematology. Hematology is not sure why you called them, but they recommend a CBC if the patient has a concern for leukemia. So it is funny that if you call the consultant and you're wrong about something or you don't need them, that sometimes there's some pretty funny things in there. All right, so the final step to finish this off, what is the disposition? Do we want to get this person to the ICU, the operating room, discharge of cardiology, discharge of no follow-up? Well, err on the safe side. He doesn't need an operating room. What are we operating on? And we don't want him to go home without follow-up. And he seems stable enough, at least based on those vitals. So let's go discharge of cardiology follow-up. And of the final diagnosis, we know he didn't have COVID-19. He didn't have a stroke based on the CT. Could have had syncope. But when we took the initial EKG, the interpretation at the bottom matches atrial fibrillation with rapid ventricular response. So let's go ahead and take that as the diagnosis. We'll click handoff. And then it wants to double check you and says, are you sure? Wait, hang on, or finish. We'll go ahead and finish. And it gives us a score, it tells us the diagnosis, and it tells us our disposition. And so I think this is a great mobile simulation. I think it is a great trigger event-based simulation. I will probably have a second video where we go over some of the limitations of it and some of the ways of breaking it. But thanks so much for watching, and that's all for now.